Good morning. Your bulletin says I'm going to play American Tune by Paul Simon, but then I changed my mind. So I've got a little something to sing, maybe a little something for you to sing. As we gather in the circle, raise our voices strong, welcoming all people. As we sing along, everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. As we sing a song of love, sing with me. Everyone is welcome. Raise your voices. Everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Sing a song of love. Sing a song of love. Come and join together. Sing for peace and freedom. Raise a call for justice. Pray for a world that's better. Sing with me now. Everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Sing a song of peace. Sing a song of peace. Come inside, come inside and find a place. No matter who you are, enter now the loving space. Gather near or far. Here we go. Everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Sing a song of joy. Sing a song of joy. One more time, everyone. Everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Sing a song of joy. Sing a song of peace. Sing a song of peace. Sing a song of love. Sing a song of love.
As the song says, everyone is welcome. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Augusta on this little wet morning. We return again together this morning to create a loving community, acting together with passion, reason, and respect, empowering us a just society. I am Rev.Nic Filzen, and I am more than happy to be here with music director David Neches, and he and I are both happy to host and co-create today's worship with Dr. Leon Spencer. Welcome. I'll give him a more extensive introduction later, and I also want to note that this morning's music will be given a special flavor by and we are all delighted to be joined by you, moving ever closer to our mission with you. Of course, visitors are welcome. We're always happy to see some new faces. And if you are a visitor, I encourage you to fill out a blue card and a seat in front or near you. And this blue card and the information on it will allow us to keep in better touch with you and also for you to keep in better touch with us. And if you'd like, I'm going to be standing out here in the hallway following the service. I'd love for you to come by and say hi, and I'd like to say hi to you, and perhaps some other folks who will say hi to you. We'll know you by your orange name tag. Well, I'm not seeing any orange name tags right now, but that doesn't mean you aren't visitors. But if your child wants to stay here and you would like them to stay here, then for the
physical quality,
they're more than welcome. And and also, even though we're not you'd like to send your kids to RE and get information later, we'll do so right after the offertory today. But if you, again, if kids want to stay here for the whole time, you're welcome. It sounds like I'm muted right now.
We're all having fun, aren't we? Now that we're starting to return to something similar to normal here, there's going to be much more going on here in our community. Here are just a few things. Go ahead and share some of our slides for us now. Our pledge drive begins on March 6th. From 2 to 5 p.m. that day, a group of volunteers will be calling everybody in our congregation, in our community, to hear from you about how you feel things are going here and how you might expand your stewardship. How will your treasure support the mission of this faith community? On Friday night, correct, there was a practice for the callers, and through that practice, we have already raised $15,000. Thank you to those who have already contributed. I hope that the rest of you will answer the call in, also that day. Next Friday at 6:45 p.m., this is just hot off the presses, we're starting a movie series here in the common room called First Friday Family Film Fundraisers. That's without a D, fun-raisers. Starting with Pixar's Toy Story. All ages are welcome, and free will donations will be accepted for attendance, food, and drink, but definitely not required. This is simply offering folks a way to get together and have fun and enjoy some time together. Even though we're getting together at 6:45, the show time is at 7. We will not hold for latecomers. The following day, on Saturday, March 5th, everyone is invited to UUCA-adopted portion of the Augusta Canal to help preserve the natural beauty of that space, to be good stewards of the interdependent web of existence that sustains us. We'll meet at 1 p.m. for a picnic lunch together, and the cleanup itself will be from 2 to 4 p.m. that day. Look for more info in the newsletter realm and Thursday's e-announcement. Another slide, please, Dee. Our inaugural service auction was postponed until April 30th, not August, sorry, April 30th. This postponement will give the auction team time to plan and implement a great evening of stewardship full of fun and talent. What skill, service, or wisdom can you offer as a donation that can help to support the mission of this beautiful community? Let Ray Randolph know on Realm or by email, and she'll add you to the donor list. It would be very, very cool if every person here could contribute at least one thing as a donation. Everyone is invited to attend a slice of pie on March 12th. This is a virtual conference of small congregations with presentations on how other folks in a similar context to us are being innovative. A great way to develop ourselves and our relationship with the wider UU world. We'll cast the presentations onto the TV in the common room, and importantly, there will be homemade pie. That's it for the slides. Dee, thank you. One final announcement before we get going. As of this morning, I've invited everyone in the Interfaith Fellowship of Augusta and Progressive Religious Coalition to plan a vigil for Ukraine and for peace. I will certainly let you all know the plans for that as they are given more shape, but I think it's important for us to show a united stand as people of faith in this community that the aggression shown in the Far East is not gonna stand. Now, as we fully enter this time of worship, and we light our chalice, I offer these words by my friend and colleague, Reverend Viola Abbott, entitled Pastoral Prayer Number 2. Let us open our hearts, still our minds, and enter a time of worship. Let us call forth and hold in our hearts the stories of all who have come before us, the memories of those who are with us today, and the hope for tomorrow and for all those who will come after us. Let us be thankful for this opportunity for healing, forgiveness, and reconciliation, while knowing that we should never forget what has brought us here today. Let us be glad that voice has not only been given to those whose sorrow and pain were their companions in this faith, but that the stories told by those voices have been received with a goal of redemption and understanding. Let us call upon that light which shines in each of us to give us the strength to walk together into the future and do the work that is necessary and which does not end here today.
Good morning again. Our opening hymn is hymn number 113. You can either follow along with the words on the screen or it's in your gray hymnal. And we ask that you rise either in body and spirit and make a joyful noise.
Hello. My name is Marika Bhattacharya. I'm sorry I'm getting a call. This is really bad. All right. I'm here representing the last thought is that I want to recognize all the joys and sorrows that you may be holding in your heart but not spoken today. Thank you.
If you took a close look at your order of service, you may have noticed things are just a little bit different than usual, just a little flip, and that's for a specific reason for later on. But now is when we're going to enter into our invitation to generosity time. And I adapted some words from Reverend Dr. Victoria Weinstein to share with you this morning as the invitation. This congregation is a theologically diverse religious community with membership open to all who are in accordance with our principles, mission, and vision. We are a welcoming congregation to people of all target identities, and we unconditionally welcome any and all of you to our community of mutual caring and serious intent to grow as spiritual and moral beings. Our congregation is self-governed entirely. One of the privileges of our free church tradition is to provide all the financial support for our many ministries from among ourselves. Generosity, therefore, is one of the spiritual values we recognize as central to our personal and our institutional well-being. You are now invited to participate in the blessing of giving as the ushers pass the plate around each concentric circle, just let it go around the circle, and accept the gifts of the congregation. Thank you. Thank you all for your generosity. So now we're going to sing the children out. though we didn't have a time for all ages, you're going to go with Tom here back to the rooms, and hopefully your souls and hearts were formed just as ours will in this space. Thank you.
As you go, may joy surround you. As you go, may you grow. Know our love is with you always. As you go,
I'm hoping that at this point in the service, we can all find a moment to reconnect with our bodies, with our souls, with our breath, feel the ground beneath us. Really keep an eye on what our bodies are feeling. Acknowledge it. Give it comfort. Whatever that feeling may be. As we enter into a time of prayer. Spirit of life and love, that co-creating spirit that is ever with us, ever part of us, moving alongside us, through us, with us. I'd like to open up this moment of a deep relationship with soul, my soul, our souls, with gratitude, out of tragedy. Gratitude and thanks for justice for Ahmaud Arbery's family and community as his murderers were found guilty of federal hate crimes just last week. Gratitude for continued justice for the family and community of George Floyd, whose murderers were found guilty of civil rights crimes this week. May both of these outcomes be the continuation of radical justice system reform in our journey together within, among, and beyond toward beloved community. I would be remiss to not name the tragedy and horror that is happening right now in Ukraine. I can't imagine going to bed one night thinking it's going to be okay, and then have a foreign military start wreaking havoc on my life, on our lives. And even if it isn't directly impacting us, the reverberations of these aggressive acts are echoing throughout the world. May we in our hearts and in our communities continue to hold up justice and peace as paramount, that we can come back into a worldwide relationship of goodwill and love. And of course, COVID continues to impact us. Even if it's not as dangerous right now, it's still impacting us in many ways, emotionally, in relationship. May its impact be short-lived as we act as loving members of society, as this community. And may we do this all together with faith that each of us here is here for the right reasons, that we're here with shared values, shared interest and love for our neighbor. And with that love, we move ever more closer to beloved community. I have about a minute of silence, and then a short song will play. Amen, Miss Jackson. Just going to do a little stage change. In a moment, I'll introduce our guest leader today, but first, let folks know that he's going to be sharing several slides as he shares his story. Almost entirely images, I believe, right? For folks at home that want to see both a slide and the image of us in somewhat balanced sizes, once I share my screen, I would first suggest to you all at home, again, this is for folks at home who want to see slides and images of us here in the sanctuary somewhat equal, to press escape to exit full screen. Then you can expand the size of the sanctuary view by clicking on a corner and dragging outward of the box. Now these are primarily directions for folks on a PC and not on their phone or tablet. I don't know how to do that on those mediums, but I'm hoping the most of you are going to be on computers. That said, Dr. Leon Spencer's work on behalf of anti-racism and anti-oppression efforts for Unitarian Universalist congregations began way back in 1985, when he helped establish the Black Concerns Working Group. He has participated in the Jubilee Working Group, the Journey Toward Wholeness Transformation Team, and the Diverse and Revolutionary Unitarian Universalist Multicultural Ministries, known as DRUM. He was appointed interim co-president of Constituent Outreach of the UA on April 10th, 2017. Dr. Spencer is an elder of Black Lives of Unitarian Universalism, known as BLUE, and co-authored The Arc of the Universe is Long. Welcome, Dr. Spencer. Thank you for joining us and for sharing your gift and your story with us today.
Thank you. I'm not used to this. Karen Mejia saying how I got over. And what I'm going to share today is just something a little different. Can you hear me? Okay. This is a blessing for me. I'm so pleased to be here with you. It's been several years since I've been in this community. When Rev.Nic asked, could I come and talk on a Sunday? I said, yes. Well, I am here. I'm excited. I've been a Unitarian Universalist for 52 years. That's since I was 10. When I thought about what to talk about, I was certain that there was much that I could talk about, but I had to decide what to talk about. I have visited here in this congregation on several occasions as the district president for the TJ district. Some of you knew me then, and I see faces here. And I remember I just called it TJ because I refused to say Jefferson again. So it still remains the TJ Justice. As Rev.Nic was saying, I was on Journey Towards I chaired just about every committee that had anything to do with race and justice, this is true, since 1984. Now my selection in 1984 was an interesting one for the Black Concerned Working Group. And it was the work of Loretta Williams, who ran our social justice programs in the UUA, who called my minister in Columbia, South Carolina, to say that she knew of anybody who could do this work, but that nobody knew. Because Loretta didn't want the same voices coming into the room again. That's how I got started. I listened this morning with a hymn, Where is Our Holy Church? And the hymn is written by Reverend Ed Wilson. Reverend Wilson was the minister emeritus at the First Unitarian Church in Dayton, Ohio. That was the first church I became involved in. He retired. He was a strong humanist. So was Dr. Gene Reeves, who replaced him as minister. He was a strong humanist in the sense that he was a sign of the Second Humanist Manifesto. And he asked some questions that I could look through with my lens about where is our holy church? Someone said he couldn't have written that being a humanist. Read the lyrics, yes he could. But for me, as Mahalia Jackson was saying, how I got over my soul, look back and wonder. There is, in this story, the truth of racism, the truth of getting over. I grew up in Savannah, Georgia. Savannah is home, the heart. As a matter of fact, I discovered that our senator, Senator Warnock, lived about two blocks away from one of my churches. One of my churches. I did not know Senator Warnock. He's a little younger than I am. And I left Savannah at an early age. I never left Savannah, but here's what Senator Warnock had to say about our stories, because I'm trying to tell my story this morning. There is so much in this story, the truth of racism in our past and in our present that is there. The struggle for liberation by Black Americans and allies, and the critical role of the Black Church, that's there too. The progress that we have made in that story, yes, and our hope for the future. We grow in different directions, yet our roots remain. We grow in different directions, but our roots remain. I've been collecting and recovering as many family pictures over several years. I was inspired by some of my work as a professor in counseling psychology and family, where I encourage my students to do what I call the family reconstruction paper, looking at their family of origin, drawing maps of their family, interviews to explore the system. The gifts that a system provides, our community provides, of learning, hopes, wishes, dreams. Blue and Drum are two organizations within Unitarian Universalism. Some of them would agree or disagree with that, and some of us would, and say, no, we're here, but we're independent.
Leon, would you remind us what those two acronyms stand for?
Okay. I'm going to remind, but I'm sort of pushed to say, how many know what I'm talking about? Because that's the way to get the accountability piece. Black Lives Unitarian Universalist Ministries. Diverse, and Drum is Diverse Revolution Unitarian Universalist Ministries. Blue serves those of us who identify as African American. And of African descent and other places too, other than what we call America. And Drum is open to all indigenous and people of color. They asked me to do an odyssey. They're doing three odysseys of two ministers and myself that we'll do separately. And the odysseys, that there was something that people of color, that I would do it with them and they could see it. Reverend Michelle Bentley, another odyssey speaker, and Reverend Mel Hoover are the other two people. Reverend Bentley and Mel Hoover, we have done our audits, but we shaped it for our communities. So this is the first time I'm doing this with white people.
What a gift. Thank you.
Thank you. It's sort of a, it's a gift, but it's, you know, it's sort of a, we're going to be in conversation, so we may as well start it. It's sort of not scary. But it's very personal. It's very spiritual. And I want this to be a brave and safe space that I can do that. Because we need the kind of brave space to do it. So, what I've done is to put our slides together. This is not the most comfortable spot for me, by the way. So I will probably throw the papers away. And after we go through my journey, then we can have some dialogue, and hopefully we can have some continued dialogue at whatever gathering that you have after service. Am I making sense here? So let's start with. Help me, Reverend Nate.
Are you looking for the next slide?
Okay. No, I want to go here. There. That's where I want to start. Where is our holy church? My soul looked back and wonder, you're looking at my holy church. My holy church is the St. Philip's AME church that argues with St. Philip's Monumental and the claim to be the oldest African American Episcopal church in Georgia. That's the church. Or I should say that's one of the churches that I attend. My family, we belong to seven churches. I didn't say we go to seven churches, we belong to seven churches. There is a difference. Thank you. In addition to St. Philip's, there was the Tabernacle Baptist Church. The Tabernacle Baptist Church, I went every Thursday because it was one of two churches, African-American churches, that was in the community that had a Boy Scout troop. We were committed and we were connected to St. Philip's AME also. The third church that you see there and how I got over is the Second African Church. Now, you say that, why does he have the second out before the first? Because that's what my grandmother Eileen would want me to do. That's why it's up. I have a story on the second. Second African was the second oldest black Baptist church in the country. All of the women in my family who attend Second African left. They left. They left, and they went to another church. The men stayed. My father and his cousin rang the church bell at Second African, then got over to Beth Eden. Beth Eden was a, or is a, no, it was a Baptist church. It's changed now. It had a very liberal ministry, and that's why the women left Second to go to Beth Eden. They went to Beth Eden because they didn't really feel, and these were strong women, but they felt that they couldn't stay and just listen. My papa, my grandfather, one of them, went to the first African Baptist church, first Bryan African. By the way, that has another kind of little competition with, there are two first Africans in Savannah, there really are. And I would go to church there with papa. And I would go, even papa died, I went. And when we got back, I can remember my grandmother Bridie saying, "So how was church?" And then she would say, "That's nice, that's wonderful. I'm glad you went. But we could go to our church next week." So she would put an ad in. What's that? Oh my goodness. It had to be very early, extremely early. Because, yeah, extremely early. None of these people had died, I was getting ready to say, because Papa had died. I appreciate the dialogue, by the way. Thank you. What you're looking at here is the first congregational church. We went there. It was around the corner from Beth Eden, by the way. And there's a little suspicion that goes on in the family because my grandmother Eileen had my father out of wedlock. The father attended First Congregational, right connected to Beth Eden. So there were always family whispers about the church connection. Because the congregational church at that time was a church of class. They had a class hierarchy. And there is the Unitarian Universalist Church of Savannah. And one of the most interesting things for me is that when Savannah had its dedication for this building, President John Burns at the time came to give the charge to, give the main address. I gave the charge to the congregation. But one of the things he mentioned was that the story of Unitarian Church of Savannah being on rollers and rolled across the city to the spot where it was, and that it was the spot of the St. Stephen's Episcopal Church, where my great-grandparents were married. And it was the Black Episcopal Church. So when I look at it, it's the Episcopal Church. I have a stake in this. Before I came here to Unitarian, it was the Baptist Center that served the community around, and it's the Savannah Unitarian Universalist Church. Am I loud enough? Okay, how's that? Okay, I'm glad you said something. Ancestors. Is there another way I can move that besides?
Are you trying to do what?
The slides and change them. Yeah. Ancestors. My name is Leon Edward Spencer. Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, thank you. This is my great-grandmother and my great-grandfather. My great-grandfather's name was Edward Leon. Leon is our family name. We are Leons, and there's a strong tradition that even when we came from slavery with my great-grandmother, my great-grandfather said he never came from slavery. And the stories were passed down because I did not know these people. Edward Leon has a little back to Africa, back to Jamaica kind of pen here. He was a boatsman, a cook, and he met Mary in Charleston. Her parents were slaves. They moved to Savannah. And this is my grandmother, my grandmother. Let's get it right. And her sister and brother. Grandmother Eileen, who left the Second Baptist Church, she cut her hair when women weren't cutting hair or weren't supposed to. She had a child out of wedlock, not in shame. She went to church, anyone she chose to go to. And she was fierce.
Leon, is this the grandmother you showed me the newspaper article about?
Oh no, she's coming.
Okay.
This is the grandmother who used to fight with the other grandmother.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Because
families, right?
Yeah, because this is the grandmother from a strong working class. She was a maid. She was a maid and one of the richest people in Savannah's home, but she said she didn't serve on anybody's plantation. She left Savannah, and moved to New York, and came back later, and married someone of her choice. These were cool people, by the way. Eileen and Bakel, sister and brothers, my father's uncle and aunt. Oh no, that's his mother and uncle. They liked to dress. They liked to go out. They liked to go out. They liked to go to church. They tell me they had the Paul Bakel the church. I want you to get a picture of this family and the spirit that's there. Uncle Riley was a jazz musician. Nobody knows the dog. Okay. And the other person we don't have a name for. We don't know. We start calling him the unknown soldier because we know that he served.
Was he an uncle?
We don't know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we really don't know. No, seriously, we don't know. You look at now at the other grandmother. Don't call her the white lady. Because she's going to correct you. And that's Papa who's with her. That's Madam Freeman. Friend who directs the Civil Rights Museum in Savannah emailed this to me a few days ago because she knew I was gathering this stuff. She also called to announce that I was dead. Yeah, this is true. I'm getting a little more relaxed now, so bear with me. She called to announce that I was dead, and she, you know, didn't think she wanted to call because some students at Savannah State for Black History Month, one group looked at her, Madam Freeman's life, and they said she has no surviving relatives. So, Barnett, the director at the museum, she said I corrected them, and she sent this, and it says Freeman School of Beauty Culture. Be independent. Learn beauty culture. Be independent. She was always giving a message to someone, and she was always getting us into St. Philip's Church, although we could go pass it around, sure. Although we could go to other places, but she always really worked to get us there. To give you an idea as to how it worked being in this kind of household, because what we take and we look at blacks and black families, and we need to take a closer look. We are rich, even when we're poor. Friday. This grandma. Our minister at St. Philip's was Dr. Murph, Dr. Henry Murph, who became a bishop in the AME church and very active in the civil rights movement. Grandma Bridie, well, tell me, what did you think of Dr. Murph's sermon this morning? Me being smart, right on it, I would tell her his sermon, and she would look at me. Do you know that I was there? And I said, yes. And she said, well, I didn't ask you to tell me what happened. I was there. I wanted to know what you thought, you're thinking. What did you think about it? We were allowed and encouraged to think. Now, we could get happy. We could celebrate many other ways, but we were thinkers. Papa died. She stayed single for, my sister would say a squint, a two. And she remarried and divorced because, as she said, it was not a fit in values. It was not a fit in contribution to community. It wasn't easy for women to divorce in those days.
What year?
I don't know.
Okay. The question for folks at home was, what year was this?
45. It had to be 45. Papa died in 45. And it's, yeah, it had to be right after 45. Yeah. The second husband didn't stay long. Okay. But I don't know that he left. Parents. My mother, Catherine. My mother was really adopted. Now, black families, we take other family members in. I got more cousins than you can think of. Someone said, well, that's Southern too. Maybe, but my mother other parents had seven children. My grandfather had seven before that, 14 altogether. One wife died, he married somebody else and had seven. He did not want my mother to stay in South Carolina and work in a field, so he sent her to be in Beaufort and Savannah. Would buy is what we call riding. She was there. She, just as my sister and I, went to the St. Benedict's Parochial School, and it was black only, except the three priests were white, and all of the nuns were white. And they would teach Mammy's little baby love shortening, shortening, Mammy's little baby love shortening bread. Yeah. Dick, Jane, everybody had yellow hair but Spot. Any of the rest of you had Dick and Jane? Let's go. Yeah. It was really yellow hair, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now, I know I'm probably going over a little bit here.
I'm not looking at the clock.
Okay, good. Good. And I like it. Ask me questions, whatever. I'm exploring. I have been exploring for a number of years. Exploring, I think I know who I am, whose I am. And I want to share that with my family, my grandchildren in particular.
Is that exploration part of what helped you find Unitarian Universalism as one of your spiritual traditions?
You got it. Yeah. We were doing Unitarian Universalist stuff. No, we were doing our stuff before I ever became a Unitarian Universalist. And I've been a Unitarian Universalist for a long time. People frequently ask, why did you leave your church? I never left my church. Never left my community. Geographically, I might have. So what is it that brought you to the Unitarian Universalist Church? You know, and they assume that I might have been running away from something. I was trying to connect. Why I suggested the hymn, Where's Our Holy Church? Because Reverend Edwin Wilson, as a humanist, had a great influence on the church that I went to, but it was much like St. Philip's and Dr. Murph. Now, I'm not saying everybody did that, but you know, you could ignore the theology sometimes or reshape it, such as whether you listen to Dr. Murph and what it is that you think. That sounds pretty Unitarian Universalist to me. Okay. My father, Leon, and he's a Spencer, born out of wedlock to some fairly rooted Spencers, African American background. And somewhere in here it was decided that we would carry the name Leon over and over. One of my granddaughters is Noelle, which is Leon backwards. There are three other Leons. My other granddaughter has a middle name of Leon. We carry it forward, and we go. That's my little prayer dish at home. We spend lots of time in cemeteries. You could call us ancestor worshipers. In the cemetery, there's black walnuts. We connect them. We collect them, rather, not connect them. I'll give you a quick story. Can I give a quick story? one of our visits to the cemetery, smaller than, we're in, and my sister and I watching folks, and these are from the cemetery, by the way, watching folks just collect these, and my sister turns to me and she whispers, take it out your mouth. You can't crack it and don't eat it. Okay? And we just forgot about that, and that was fine. The following Christmas, my two great aunts called us to their house. Wood stove, kerosene lamp. And they set us down for tea. And they go to a couch that didn't look like a couch. And they reach under and they pulled out a black walnut cake. They placed it on the table. And they said, eat this. Said, eat this. It was like a communion. They said, these are our people and our ancestors. And they never gave the recipe away. But it was wonderful. So I collect them. Collect Saint Benedict, who was the only black in that Catholic school in any position. They had the name. Does that make sense? But I can remember going around and looking for Saint Benedict's. I found the Blessed Virgin. I found the Sacred Heart of Jesus. I found Saint Joseph. These are statues. And I said, well, where in the hell is Saint Benedict? That's just what I said.
Probably not in hell.
Probably not.
Yeah.
But he was in a corner. And I would talk to him and say, what are you doing here? He never talked back. But I did get out of St. Benedict's. And I have good memories of St. Benedict's. I had some wonderful nuns. But I think it was no kind of awareness around race. There was a little awareness with the nuns around justice, but not much, because the nuns who worked justice were Mother Beasley and the black nuns who existed there before in Savannah, who were really put out of business. Internalized identities. My cousins in Charleston went to ICS, Immaculate Conception, where they did have black nuns. But one of them one day said, your school is better, you have white nuns. Think about that. Your school is better, you have white nuns. No. That's St. Benedict's, the class of 1932. It's my mother in the center there. I think that's Father Albrecht, who was in charge of everything.
It's fascinating. They centered the white priest there in the middle.
That was his place.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. That was his place, and he controlled it all. Education was important, as it is with most families, African-American families. This is my dad's school, Kyla. There were junior high school graduations. He's there. If I pointed at him, you wouldn't know him at any rate, but he's there on that top row somewhere. the one who looks like me, or I look like him. Madam Freeman in 1919. When she said to make independent women, that's her graduation class of 1940. If you go to the Civil Rights Museum in Savannah, and the exhibit is there, it's about what was taught in the school, not how to just press hair, but what was taught in that school. One day I'm going to do a talk on being a child on the floor of a beauty school or a beauty shop, and all I could see were the white shoes, and I could hear the chatter, and I could figure out everybody's voice. And they would talk. It was the greatest teaching in the world. It taught me a heck of a lot about being a man. Once in a while, this person by the name of Mina Lee, I haven't heard that name again, she would look around and she would say, "Stop, Bubba's on the floor." And they would stop for a moment and then go back to the chatter. That was learning. I learned about justice. I learned about relationships. When a black deacon in, I think it was Bryant's church, was convicted and set to be executed. The amount of social justice work that went on in catching the pennies, as they called them, collecting money, it did not save him, but W.W. Law, who is a Savannah historian, mentor, he's gone now. I guess he's here. W.W. Law, he said, let's count the number of children that these women had who were sent to college. He said, do you have any idea? Of course, I didn't. But I started counting. I can't give you a number, but I counted. Another class, 45. They're a little more patriotic with the American flag, as you can see. They had a problem. I love my sister. She can make comments, things like this. She said, they're too old to have a prom. No, they had a prom. My father's best friend returned from the service. It was in the late 40s. And people didn't have a lot of places to go. They entertained in their homes. There's Madame Cargo, the other madam of the city. Not the kind of madam we're talking about. Think about the president of Savannah State, Dr. Jordan, the minister. They gathered. The person who returned from the military was killed in a car accident shortly after that. How am I doing with time? I want to run through quickly.
I'm curious if you could share. You mentioned how your exploration helped you get to Unitarian Universalism. I'm curious, once you've incorporated that into your life and you were incorporated into that tradition, how it helped to make you whole, complete you?
Well, you know, when I looked at that question, I'm not complete. And so I don't, I've gone to seven churches. I stay home a lot now, by the way. I do more visiting the churches than I do mine, although I love it. Unitarian Universalism didn't make me whole. It opened the possibility. It opened the possibility to look at a journey towards wholeness. But bear in mind, when we came into, many of us, Unitarian Universalism, there were unfulfilled promises. There was the walkout, where African Americans asking for social justice and having to walk out.
So it's 63, right?
63, right. Yeah. And Unitarian Universalism, once we started to look at taking our responsibility and white people doing the work of anti-racism. This is not a black thing or a person of color thing. I think that I wanted to ask the question to white Unitarian Universalists as to how do you feel complete with this? You know, if you look at, you guys looked at the eighth principle here?
Some of us.
Did I say something wrong?
Not institutionally, but I know it's been discussed by some of us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's an interesting process. Go look at the eighth principle. It deals specifically around the issue of race and wholeness and completeness. And it's a challenge. My church adopted it. They adopted it about a month ago. After a long period of time, and I'm not telling a secret here, you know, you don't tell family secrets, you get out. On a long struggle, a real long struggle, I became a friend of my congregation rather than a member. I didn't go somewhere else, but I said I've changed my status to friend. Because you don't need the people of color in the congregation working these issues. They're issues for all of us. And sometimes there's a heavy burden, and that's what I was feeling with the eighth principle. If there's a question around race, let's call. And that's not just me, it can be with anybody.
Work for all of us.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's why some of us can breathe in blue and just breathe a little bit and drum in people of color groups. Didn't say we were running away or going to do something else. I'm glad you're asking the question because it's one that's there. All I'm saying is that what I'm sharing here, my values were rooted there.
Yeah.
Unitarian Universalism didn't make me. The promise of Unitarian Universalism was very exciting to me because Unitarian Universalists were involved in the Civil Rights Movement. We could talk about James Reed, Viola, Rousseau. We didn't talk as much about Jimmy Jackson, by the way, until later when some of us confronted, said, you know, there were three people killed. It gets hard to confront all the time. We need breathing, just to breathe. Now, if I didn't think I could breathe here, I wouldn't be talking about this. I really don't. And because you would have let me, I think, talk about just about anything that I wanted to talk about. And I said, well, let's try this. And I appreciate it. And why I appreciate it is because I'm at a texturized stage of life. And I start to collect this, and it's a spiritual piece, and I want to share it more. That's why we had the sharings in Black Lives Matter and in Trump. So I thought with the dialogue, it would be interesting to share this with a larger group.
I think it's fascinating. Yeah. You've shared with me, and you may have mentioned it here, that you were born in Savannah. Mm-hmm. You physically left Savannah, but Savannah never left you. And you mentioned that the same thing happened with, was it your grandma, right?
Absolutely.
And there's an interesting correlation there, I think, mm-hmm. where telling this story is kind of your return to Savannah, your roots, your grounding. And you can't move on and tell the rest of the story without starting in that place. That space is part of you.
Well, it maybe it's a Savannah thing, because I noticed the same thing with Senator Warnock. You know Senator Warnock's from Savannah. Pardon?
I voted for him.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. Oh, I shouldn't say that. But anyway, yeah. But you couldn't take this, we're in dialogue, I think.
I think so.
You couldn't take this and say that that's the experience of African Americans in Savannah. Don't forget, Clarence Thomas is from Savannah. Went to St. Benedict's School.
Mm. I did not know that connection.
Yeah. He left. And he's back to being a Catholic now. Very interesting. But he left. He wanted to be a priest. See, this is when my values start to slip out, too. I was going to say, I'm saying it now, God forbid. So, I think that there's a process. I think that the church plays a part in it. Mm-hmm. I think that the church that Senator Warnock's father ran, which was a little storefront that I can't even remember where it was, I think that they probably had something to offer, just as St. Philip's, first African, second African, but the Presbyterian or wherever else. They weren't this place of an overpowering, this place of, thank you. They weren't this place of, they weren't the special site in Savannah. The piece is from the rest of this. We practice Gullah. Anybody's familiar with Gullah?
I just learned about it when we spoke last week. Is this
the Gullah culture? Everybody know the food. It's the South Carolina, Georgia Sea Island. Penn Center, where Unitarians were involved at Penn Center, was one of those places that we medication, herbal, the food. Oh, gosh. Somebody said, oh, yeah. 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 The food is special. Dufusky Island. Lots of Gullah culture there. Go to Dufusky and go to the little church that is still there and the prayer house that's still there. I entered and I cried. And a photographer was coming in, a white photographer, and he looked at it like it was just a piece of whatever. But it was just a sight to take a picture and get a nice picture of it. Unitarian Universalism, I want to be able to bring all my pieces there. That's what I thought when I became a Unitarian Universalist. Social justice pieces. But then the reality, we had problems within our community. Mm-hmm. The problems that we had were really rooted in racism. You wouldn't call it that. Sexism. But I think that what it was rooted in is a white supremacy culture.
What does that phrase mean to you?
White supremacy culture. It means that from our history and our events and the things I'm sharing and the learnings that we have is that there's a hierarchy where being white is better. Mm-hmm. There is the privilege of it. We all get socialized into a white supremacist culture, whether we are black, white, whoever. We're all socialized that way. What?
As the dominant culture, right?
That's right. But yeah. What? And not the dominant culture with power we're talking about,
right,
too, in supremacy. But the thing is that we get so uncomfortable talking about white supremacy. And it's a place that all of us can work on. The inferiority kind of piece. I realize my back is to you folks. Well, I'm talking with you.
It's that within piece, right? That within, among, and beyond.
We
first work on it right here.
Yeah, and we have to connect. And how do you know that you're working on it? You know, how do you really know if you're working on it?
Usually when I'm uncomfortable.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and none of us like being uncomfortable.
We don't.
No, none of us like being uncomfortable. And we are socialized in a white supremacist culture. And that includes Unitarian Universalists. I was born in the Georgia Infirmary Hospital for Coloreds. That says a lot for itself, doesn't it? Georgia Infirmary Hospital for Coloreds did not have any black professional doctors or doctors practicing.
Sounds like St. Benedict's.
It sounds like St. Benedict's. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I hadn't thought of that one, but yeah. They had two black nurses, Nurse Madison, and I can't think of the other. You know people in the community if you're there. Mm-hmm. And they had them, but you can't hear. There you go. Oh, okay. I thought I was whispering up here. But the thing about it is that white is better. I have three friends. We're all old-timers and professionals, and we had a conversation about how we thought at a time that we were better. We got the better. We went to the hospital. And my sister corrected me, as usual. And she said, I was delivered by Grandma Eileen and Aunt Tardy.
At home, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
722 Paulson Street. Say, so who is it that got the better connection. What do you mean that you are, it was better? And it's just there. Does that make sense? Some people internalize that. Others, certainly I've internalized some, but I'm saying here that I had enough people in a community and a family that could help me to deal with the pieces around white supremacy culture. White people need to deal with white supremacy culture also, and among themselves, not to ask people of color, what should I do? You know, this happened to me, or you just have to meet this friend of mine. He's a white minister. And you're going like, huh? Well, how many times do we get approached with, oh gosh, I can't wait to introduce you to George. And I can bet George is black. And yeah, I'm about ready. And you think you've done the connection.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm not blaming anybody. I'm just calling what I see. I'm calling what we all in this room live under. We all in this room, you wouldn't be sitting here, I don't think. And particularly the UUA now is really beginning to deal with white supremacy. And if you can, I brought a magazine. The UUA's. Yeah. Anybody's looked at that? This is one of the most profound issues of the UU world. Most profound.
We have two copies in the building if anybody wants to read it. One in my office and one in the bookshelf by the common area.
And I have a couple at home, and I'll sell you one of these. No.
Free will donation, right?
No, I'll leave it here. But it's a profound issue.
It's the fall, the most recent fall issue. Yeah.
Our faith calls us to anti-racism work. Not only dealing with also people of color and indigenous people issues. It's our issues, really.
Well, if I may, Dr. Spencer, I know that you're willing to stick around after the service to chat a little bit more, and I'm wondering if in that environment we can continue to the discussion and have some more questions from the
absolutely
from the congregation.
Yeah.
I think hearing your story and hearing how you've connected some of your religious roots, all 45 of them, and how that has kind of emerged in your UU identity, has been a really special thing for me to hear today. And I hope everyone else has also gotten a lot out of it.
I hope this doesn't end. This will end. But I hope that our commitment as an association, that I think it's just beginning.
I like how you said the journey, we're always journeying toward wholeness, right?
Absolutely.
In this, I like this idea of people say they're woke. That's a very finalized thing. But I'd like to say that we're in the process of waking. And it sounds like that's what we're trying to do here as Unitarian Universalists. And having your wisdom as part of that is more than worthy.
Thank you. There's a piece in here that I've thumbed through.
Yeah.
It's Mark's piece, Reverend Mark Marston Reed. Mm. And if you're familiar with Reverend Mark Marston Reed, we'll just find it. You say, how do we take it from here? That's a great question. And I think Mark's piece really answers that, or at least it proposes something. And let me try to find it. Appreciate your patience here. The central task of the religious community is to unveil the bonds that bind each to all. Once felt, it inspires us to act for justice.
Amen.
And that was going to be the closing reading, not from here, but from the hymnal.
Well, would you like to do our last hymn?
I can.
Last hymn?
Sure.
Thank you, Dr. Spencer.
Thank you. I hope this is, yeah. We got it.
Are the drums muted still? I knew how it would feel to be free.
So, hang on a second, Owen. So, Dr. Spencer and I were talking earlier today, not earlier this week, and he said he would really wish we could do I Wish I Knew number 151, and he said, but they always try to do it in Statesboro, but they always have trouble. And I said, we do it here all the time, and we have no trouble seeing it. So now that I've opened up my mouth on that, I hope y'all can support me.
I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all these chains holding me. I wish I could say all the things I could say. Say them loud, say them clear, for the whole world to hear. Say I'm loud, say I'm clear, for the whole world to hear. I wish I could share all the love in my heart. Remove all the bonds that still keep us apart. I wish I could know what it means to be me. Then you see and agree, everyone should be free. Then you see and agree, everyone should be free. Wish I could give all I'm longing to give. I wish I could live like I'm long to live. I wish I could do all the things I could do. Though I'm way overdue, I'm starting anew. Though I'm way overdue, I'd be starting anew. I wish I could be like a bird in the sky. How good it would be if I found I could fly. I'd soar to the sun and look down at the sea. Then I'd sing, 'cause I know how it feels to be free. Can I sing? 'Cause I know how it feels to be free. Yeah. As we leave this gathering, and as we go out into community, let us remember that the central task of the religious community is to unveil the bonds that bind each to all. Once felt, it inspires us to act for justice. Act for justice. Spirit of life, come unto me, bring in my heart all the sins of compassion. Blowing the wind, rising the sea, moving the hand, giving life the shape of justice, rules on.